Tack för det. So yes, I'll do this in English. I understand most Swedish, but I don't think you understand me if I try to speak Swedish to you. What we can see here is actually our the biggest order in NanoSat satellite industry ever. Let me see, can I point with this? This is an 8-unit satellite. I have here in front of me a 2-unit, just to so you can compare in real size. We're going to produce more than 200 satellites of this for a customer called SkySpace and Global, using it for telecommunication in the Africa and less developed countries. We're quite glad of this order. It's an order of up to 7 million euro, and we are already in stage where we are delivering this order. And with that, that's also mean that we are a company that now have the biggest order backlog ever in the company's history, and that's why our growth is also exceeding our original plans. We went to the stock exchange less than two years ago. This is not me. This is my name is Troels. I'm the CFO in the company. This is our CEO Niels Buus. He was unfortunately not able to be here and do this presentation. Last week, he was actually won an award as the leader in Denmark, the leader of the year. So we celebrated that last week, but it's not because he has celebrated too much and he can't attend today. So, short about the GomSpace. We just have our 10-year in September. It was established, founded in 2007 in Aalborg. What's special about GomSpace is that we from day one started selling our products. So we didn't do as many other startups, do a lot of development and then improve that for many years and then start selling the product after some years. From day one, we start selling our products. So that's part of our history. Always producing and engineering what's that on concrete orders in the market. We are based in Aalborg, and we are located nearby the university in Aalborg. We have operation ops also here in we have our headquarters here in Stockholm, but the main part of the organization in Sweden is located in Uppsala, north of Stockholm. We also have a subsidiary in US, and we have in Singapore, and also in Luxembourg. I'll go back to where, what we why we are representing these areas. We are roughly 170 employees at the moment, and as I told you, we were listed almost 1.5 years ago. What we have achieved in GomSpace is that we were the first one being able to track airplanes with small nanosatellites, actually a satellite this size. We are also the first one to deliver a nanosatellite to ESA, European Space Agency, and we believe we are among the strongest with a product portfolio for nanosatellites, meaning all the subcomponents to produce one satellite and the entire satellite. We have customers in since we start selling our products from day one. We have also customers and been selling to now it says 55 countries, actually more, and we have participated in more than 40 missions, also having our products in space, tested in space. And as I started, we have the biggest contract for nanosatellites in the industry. So what we thing is our competitive advantage is that our products are tested in space, and they've been tested for several years now. And in space, it's very important that you can documentate that your products are working in space, because when they are put in space, you have no chance of doing any repair. Then you cannot go grab them again. Then they are lost. So having the necessary quality and have tested the products is very important, because you only get one shot. Furthermore, in Aalborg area, we have always been in the front end when it comes to mobile technology and all the wireless. Meaning that when it's come to radio technology, that is one of our key competences. And the reason for that is that we have a lot of, all the mobile industry was actually being developed, a lot of that part in the same region. And the special thing about mobile technology is that you can do very advanced technology with very small devices. And that fits perfect when you're producing small satellites. And that's why radio technology is the main part of our competence. So our mission is quite broad. We're saying we are helping teams across the globe to achieve their goals in space. And having that said, it's our vision to make the nanosatellite the preferred choice for customers who have a professional mission, critical radio base, surveillance or communication solution. And what we're trying to communicate is saying that we are not an RD company primarily. We produce satellites that's going to operate for some kind of commercial or defense or surveillance mission. Then we have communicated clear that we are going to sell our products as a horizontal company. That's what we're trying to show here. So we are going to have a scale of production and to be very cost effective. We need to use the same standard platform for all our customers abroad. So we use the same power systems, the same solar panels, the same structure, and then we can divide it to a lot of different customers. And that's important to have this scale of production so we can lower the cost. But beside that, we also say we do participate in spin-out activities. And this is to communicate if you have the entire, you have the end user up here, and then you have digging the minerals, probably not that, but all the subcomponents down here. Then we say when there is a possibility and there's no competitors in the market, and nobody has seen this commercial potential, we do invest in these areas. And that's why we have an ownership in a company called Aerial and Maritime that do airline tracking in developing countries. I'll tell you a little more about that short moment. Last week, or the week before, we actually communicated that we have decreased our ownership in this company because there was new investors injecting $5 million to this company, and they're going to go from 4 satellites to 8 satellites now and reach 80 satellites to do this global airline tracking. That's the goal with this company. So now I've been talking a little about the company and maybe should explain a little more what a nanosatellite is. So the first one is that it's a satellite that is smaller than traditional satellites. It's based on the cell phone components in the industry. And the important thing is this is to do smaller units, basically always decreasing the size of the components. A nanosatellite, one unit, this is a 2 unit, it's around 1 kilo for each unit. And that's why we say they go from 1 to 30 kilos. We believe and we know that the satellites compared to traditional satellites is more than 1,000 times cheaper. And that's basically the main reason why we see this demand. Just to give some fundamentals about the satellites, we say one unit, if you only buy one, cost around 1 million Swedish krona. So if you have 2 units like this, you could say it should be 2 million. But when you go up in size and you buy more, then the price will of course decrease. So if you only buy one satellite and one unit, it will be around 1 million for the satellite. And then you need to have it put in space, and that will cost around 900,000. So this satellite, with the same estimate, will cost 2 million to buy it from us, and then they will pay around 1 million, maybe so 3 million in total, to have such a satellite produced, built, and put into space. And that's, of course, a lot of money, but compared to traditional space industry, it's very few. It's very low capital you need to set up a company. The reason why the price for having a satellite launch in space is decreasing is that they are back seats, also meaning that they are not the. We have to wait that for a big satellite is going to bring something in space, and then they can bring the smaller one as backseat satellites. What we see in the market is now that they are getting small dedicated rockets, and that's increasing quite fast, that market. And that will increase the supply of launchers that could put these our small satellites in space. A nanosatellite is only 500 to 800 kilometers away from the Earth. So that's why it circulates, it takes a satellite 90 minutes to go around equator. And that's meaning that if in for some one day you have one satellite like this one, it will be able to cross over all the parts of the globe in around one day or more or less. If you need a satellite to have visual on Earth or connectivity all over Earth, then you'll need around 5 orbits with up to 80 satellites or something like that, depending on the mission. You can use a nanosatellite for different things. Yeah, Internet of Things, that's basically connecting devices. When it's nanosatellites, it's most about connecting areas in remote spaces where there's no connectivity. You can use it for example, as I told you, tracking aircraft and ships. It's like a radar you put in the orbit, and it can look down instead of having a radar looking up. This SkySpace and Global are using these 200 satellites I showed in the beginning for communication, also voice and messages. Remote sensing is, for example, if you need to have some awareness about where if you're using a satellite telephone, could be one explanation that you can, with our satellites, see that there's a signal going somewhere from the globe, and then you can use it to locate. We have a product that we're selling, satellites for the Danish defense, where they're going to do some surveillance in Arctis to monitor that area. So this is a slide to show you what are happening and why we've disrupting is a word using in many sentences, but we actually mean that we are actually disrupting something. We have the history where small mainframe computer are now you have the same computer power more or less in much smaller devices. You have the cell phone industry where this big one of the first cell phones haven't got the same futures and possibilities as you have a small satellite, or small, and this is actually, now we are talking about smartphones, and you can actually saying that they are competing with the computer today. So this is just to give an example how things are developing. And what we're saying is that we have this traditional big satellite, you can actually see this is a person standing next to it, and then you have our satellites. This is actually the same size as this one, if you have a in a person's hand, saying that we are disrupting the satellite industry in the same way as other industries have been disrupting. Going back a little about, if you need to cover the entire globe, I just saw it, we need 5 orbits. In some reason there's 6 orbits in this drawing, but you need 5 orbits to have satellites. And then you need to spread them around the globe. And for tracking, for example, this area maritime, where you're going to track planes and ships or the entire globe, they will need around 80 satellites to do this kind of mission. In the beginning I told you about the communication system, they are using more than 200 satellites just to cover some part of the globe. And if you're going to use, and the reason for that is the more demanding instrument or future you build on the satellite, you need more power, and you need, and you can do that in two ways. You can do bigger satellites, or you can put more satellites. So that's something that we calculate on, and saying that's why we say here, if it's a demanding high bandwidth communication system, you probably need 3,000 satellites. And an important thing in our history is that we are building satellites to last for 5 years, because we use standard electronics, and developing the technology go so fast, so you have a lot of new features with new and the processors and the microchips are improving so much between in these 5 years that it's actually cost effective to send up new satellites because you have improved performance of the satellites. And that's also meaning that every time we participate in a constellation having many satellites up, every 5 years we're going to reduce roughly around 20% of the constellation. And that's why we have it's very important for us to win the contracts in the beginning, because then we also have a good chance to be replacing them afterwards and having a recurring business in that way. I think I'll just go quickly through this. This is the Sky Space and Global Orbital, the one in the beginning. So it's a contract up to 70 million euro, and we're going to deliver this satellite or this constellation between three and a half year now. Our products, we are selling the entire solutions. That's what we put up here. And to produce a solution, you need the subsystems. That's all the solar panels that you can see here. Inside there is battery, computers, microprocessor, the structure. We also provide the ground station. We have this Swedish company here in Uppsala that provide us with the propulsion systems. That's small gas tanks. That's one of the you can put in the satellites, and then you can actually move it around in constellation to have the right distance between the satellites. Then we add the payload, and that's the instrument you're using on the satellite for something. For example, I talked about the ADS-B transponder and the AES. That's for tracking airlines or ships. We also provide the platform, and then we assist our customers. This is not the main operation, that's something we do to facilitate having the satellites up in space, and that's why we have a company that actually buy the facility. We don't buy the rockets, but we charter the entire rocket, and then we sell the space or the slots like when you charter an entire airplane, and then you split up it in smaller seats. So we don't buy rockets, but we buy the entire facility on a rocket. And that all of this goes into a solution. And when it's a solution, we also provide some ground station software. We also provide services having operating the satellite's constellation. To show you, we're using the same subsystems put into the same platform, and then we put a specific payload on the satellite. And that's why we're saying that we're using the same subsystem, the same structure, adding a specific payload. And we sell it out to four overall segments. We have the academia, science, defense, and commercial. And where we see the highest growth in is the commercial area, using nanosatellites for commercial operations. We started doing most of the academia and also in science. Academia is universities. Sciences could be NASA, ESA. And defense is, for example, I told you about this Danish defense that's going to do surveillance in Arctic. And commercial is the Sky Space and Global Order doing communication systems. We think they're all important to have volume and scale of production. And a lot of the person starting at the university are going to be hired in these areas afterwards. And that's why that's one of our entrance to the market. Short about the market potential, overall there's a much more potential that we will ever be able to supply in short time. The market is growing very fast. This is actually a report last year. It's actually the market, the total satellite market is more than 260 or 270 million billion dollars. We say that our main part could be within the manufacturing. That's 8% of that. And then we have made an estimate of how big the market potential is for the small satellites, because you cannot use the entire 8% with the nanosatellites. And that's given us a market potential above $3.1 billion. And we will not be able to do turnover in $3.1 billion in 2021. Besides that, there's also the satellite service. As I showed you in the beginning of the slide, we have set up a company in Luxembourg where we can do some operation of the satellite. So that's not included in these numbers. So we try to give a long-term vision for nanosatellites. And what we basically are saying is that if we, this is a radio tower, where I put a device. This is typically located on and ground in cities and around the globe. We say that some of these instruments sitting on these radio towers could be put on a nanosatellite, and then you can distribute to the entire globe instead of putting up the mast. We have made some estimations saying that there are several hundreds of thousands ground stations, and then they are not covering the entire Earth, far away from that. So that's why we're saying the potential for having nanosatellites up in space, not replacing the radio towers, but replacing some of the instruments sitting up there, is a potential for our industry. When it comes to our competitors, we have overall four competitors. We have one in Europe here and one in UK, Clydespace, still Europe, and then we have the remaining two in US. And we have an estimate saying that we are almost same size. I actually believe that we are growing much faster than our competitors at the moment. I started saying something about aerial and maritime, and that's just an example saying that sometimes we do invest in spin-out activities, and this is an example where we're using our nanosatellites to track airplanes, and this company is set up to operate tracking of airplanes in this region, and that will cover around 112 countries, and that is the company that has just been having new investors on board, and we're increasing from four to eight satellites, and they're reaching a global constellation to cover the entire Earth. If you look at our owners, we are having a free float of our shares of roughly 45%. The remaining part are from some of the founders. We have Borean represented having 20% represented by Carl Erik and Jesper Jespersen. We have Hansen Langeland. They were one of the biggest IT companies in Denmark some years ago. Representing by Steen Hansen. And then we acquired this company in Sweden from Swedish Space Corporation, and some of the payment was done in shares, and that's why they have 2%. And we also have the CTO in Swedish Space Corporation, Anna Ratsman, in the board. Our chairman is Jukka Pertola, a former CEO of Siemens. The management team, I just shortly presented Niels Buus. We have our CTO, Dan Ulrich. He has a lot of experience also in defense company and companies that do product engineering, Therma. We also have our CCO, commercial officer, Børge Vitoff. He also has been involved in selling complex system sales and a lot of within the defense and security industry, but latest he has done a lot within the commercial. Then we have myself, I'm a former auditor. If we look at our financial, then when we went listed, we said that we're going to grow 70% yearly. We're going to hit a gross margin above 50%, and we say it will be around 350 persons in 2021. You can see the financial history. We just released a new quarterly report this morning, and if we compare the last 3 years on 9 months, we can see that our growth have gone up with around 80%, so above our growth target. What we see is our gross margin has decreased from it was actually above our long-term goal to 29%. I'll go. The reason for that we are lowering our gross margin is that we are building up the company. So we take a lot of the cost in the end, building up the company, and then we need to see that the growth continue, and then we'll lower our expenditure when we grow. Setting up a company also means that we are investing a lot in the company. We're setting up a new ERP system, all the production areas around this, meaning that we actually have a negative result. If you can see the growth in our staff, here you can see that we've grown from more than 55 to 150 employees compared to last year at the same time. The important thing is that when we are increasing, you can see this is the engineer part of the organization, it has grown from 62% to 74%. So we are growing, but we are growing with the production and engineers in this company. also meaning that the sales have actually been smaller part of the organization, also administration actually be relative lower compared to last year. Another important thing is always to see if we have sufficient cash to generate such a growth. And what you can see here is we've actually been able to maintain the working capital at the same level as last year, and we still have a strong cash position and equity ratio above 70%. Last slide is that since we went listed, we promised the market that we'll establish these subsidiaries. We have done that. We have acquired the Swedish propulsion system. We have developed our products, and as you can see in the market, we're selling them. We have implemented a new ERP system, and we have hired many people to facilitate that growth. So I can see, and I take a little more time, so I think I'll stop here.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. We have run out of time, so we have just I think 4 or 5 minutes for questions. So please sit down in the middle here. I think it's better for the broadcasting. So we can. I will start to ask if there are any questions from the audience. Yes. Okay.
What is the limiting factor for the very short lifetime, 5 years?
Okay, it was a question about the lifetime, 5 years lifetime. Shall we take that first?
Yes. When you put electronics in space, they are then you have radiation that are actually destroying the satellites. The radiation is not that we are low Earth, meaning that the radiation is much lower than the traditional satellites, much more, but that could be some of the limitation. Another one is solar storms and having the components working in orbit, but primarily it's radiation that actually decreased the lifetime of the goods.
Okay, thank you. And your second question?
It was won in two steps, and now it's 70 million euro.
Okay, it was about the size of the order, I think.
The size of the order? Yeah. It was 70 million euro.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Any more question? Okay, you can also ask question outside after the presentation. You have reported this morning your third quarter figures, and you show us the figures, but and your operating loss is growing, and I think it's your plan. You're expanding it, but when do you think you have positive break even? When do you think you reach break even?
Yeah. When we went listed during the IPO process, we said that we'll be break even within a couple of years.
Okay.
So we haven't been out communicating any more specific than that. Saying that is that what we see is that the market exceeds our expectation, and we can see that we are, for example, the 80%. If after we have eliminated partial revenues, so we're actually growing more than the 80%, and meaning that. When we're building up the company, our expenditure also grows. We have to take in a lot of employees to train them, and that costs a lot of money. Yeah. So that's put our earnings on a pressure in the short time.
And how about your need for new money? When do you think you need money from a new issue?
We haven't any specific plans of raising capital, but at the latest AGM in April, we have a mandate of issuing I think it was 4.8 million new shares. So we are a company that where we have communicating saying that we have sufficient funds for our current plans, but as we see, as the market is growing, and we see the importance in always having securing the orders, and that takes some working capital to be able to do so. And that's one of the reasons we are a listed company, is to have access for capital when there's a demand for it.
Yes. Okay, we have run out of time, and so that was my last question. And as I said, you can ask more questions to Truls outside room here. And okay, thank you very much for a very interesting presentation.